total of, if you can get this now, a total of more than 2.5 billion, with a B, ounces have been moved in and out of the COMEX over the last 9.5 years.
Yeah.
Now, if you follow silver, you know that 2.5 billion ounces is about as much or more of all the silver that we have in the world.
Hello there, my friends, and welcome back to SilverFest. Still broadcasting live here Sunday afternoon. Hope you just enjoyed some technical analysis from Christopher Mullen. Thank you, Chris, for sharing that. And fortunately, I know a lot of people are excited. A very special guest next here. We don't have video, but you will be able to hear him. You'll recognize the voice. One of the key figures without whom this conference or any of the stuff I'm doing probably would not have happened, because he opened my eyes when I thought it was a little odd, the pricing in 2011. That is, of course, silver manipulation expert Ted Butler of Butler Research. So, Ted, it's great to have you here today. And how are you doing, sir?
I'm doing fine, Chris, and thanks so much for the invitation.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you here on our very first SilverFest. Hopefully each one we celebrate, we'll just watch the price go a little bit higher. And great topic that really you're the only one that's qualified to address, because you've studied this for so long. And that's the mysterious silver turnover on the COMEX. What's going on? I mean, certainly it seems unusual. I did have a 1,000-ounce bar stored at one point, and I remember any time they looked at it, you know, there was a bill for a couple hundred bucks. So it's bizarre that you would see silver, large piles of it, shifting from different warehouses, and perhaps you can break down what's going on there and what you're seeing.
Sure. It's a story that goes back a long way. Taken a special interest over the last, nine and a half years or so. But what I'm talking about is a very unusual, unprecedented, unique to silver, not any other commodity, either on the COMEX, including gold and copper and palladium, platinum, zinc, and any other metal that's stored there, or to my knowledge, any exchange, warehouse, any place in the world, London or elsewhere. And what it is that starting in April of 2011, which is about 9.5 years ago, same time that J.P. Morgan opened up its COMEX warehouse, basically, we started this unusual physical movement, turnover, whatever word you want to use, where 1,000-ounce bars of silver were being brought in by truck into the various COMEX warehouses. There's 10 of them now. I forget how many there were back in 2011. I think it was a little bit less. Or the same, not the same metal, but different silver being taken out of the various COMEX approved warehouses and put onto trucks and taken elsewhere, nobody can know where it was going to. But turnover is defined by this physical turnover. It's not a paper transaction by any stretch of the imagination. It's physical silver being brought on trucks, usually in truckloads or quantities or around 600,000 ounces per truckload. No idea why, but I have been following on a daily basis by phone, calling the COMEX since their statistics department since the late 1980s, every day to get certain statistics. I'm a COMEX silver statistics junkie. I'm addicted to the statistics. And I would call every day and find out what the warehouse stocks were in silver, what the movement was that day. I don't know why I was doing it. I just did it, and it became a habit, and did it all through. Eventually, it switched over from phone calls to where they put it up on their website on just a regular internet thing. You didn't have to call the statistics department anymore. But around the two, I don't know why I was doing it, but it was just with a habit. And I would check the movement every day and warehouse levels, what the totals were. And in April 2011, it went from up until April 2011, it was only maybe a million ounces or so per week that were moved physically in and out of the COMEX. Starting in April 2011, it exploded to 5 million ounces a week, and then more recently it's been 6 million ounces a week, okay? I would define, if somebody brought in a million ounces in one day and took out a different amount of a million ounces of other silver, I would count that as 2 million ounces. That would be 2 million turnover. So a 6 million, like this past week, we had a 10 million ounce turnover. It was basically, I think, something like 700 in and 200 out, or some number like that, because we went up, I think, almost 5 million ounces or so on the total. But the total turnover, the actual physical movement, was 10 million ounces. So it's been averaging about 6 million ounces for the last couple of years, 5 million ounces a week for the years before that. And when it comes to over the 9.5 years that I've been following this, writing these numbers down every day and calculating, thinking about it, is that a total of, if you can get this now, a total of more than 2.5 billion, with a B, ounces have been moved in and out of the COMEX over the last 9.5 years.
Yeah.
Now, if you follow silver, you know that 2.5 billion ounces is about as much or more of all the silver that we have in the world. Every place that we know silver and think that we know silver exists in 1,000-ounce bars, not 3.9, pot fineness, etc. So there's been 2.5 billion ounces that have been moved in and out, and the pace is accelerating. It's not slowing down. It's not remaining the same. It's accelerating. Now, if it was, the question becomes, well, who's moving this silver and why is this going on? And why is this going on just in COMEX silver warehouse inventories? Basically, it's either investment demand or industrial user demand. One of the two things. Silver is the only real commodity that's a dual demand profile, where you have, it's both an investment asset, as most of the people listening here today, I'm sure, are interested in silver as an investment. But it's also a vital and strategic industrial commodity used in everything that you use, electricity and electronics, and whether it's solar panels or cars, whether they're internal combustion or electric, you need silver. Anytime you use electricity where performance is needed, you need silver, period. So we know that there's a big industrial consumption component to silver. Well, in thinking about it, in fact, just as recently, the last couple of days, because there's no discussion on this whole issue, and there should be, because it's very unusual. Well, 2.5 billion ounces, okay, have been physically moved in and out of the COMEX warehouses. If it were investors buying silver, they would just leave it there, okay? There's no reason. It's a great place to store silver. The COMEX warehouses, it's insured, it's guaranteed, it's audited. No one's ever lost a penny on holding physical silver at the COMEX. Great place to store silver. Well, if it was investors that are buying this 2.5, they've been buying this 2.5 billion ounces, we wouldn't have 350 million ounces in the COMEX warehouses. We'd have 2 or 2.5 billion ounces in the COMEX warehouses if it were investors buying. So it can't just be investor buying. It has to be industrial user, demand. Investors buying on the COMEX and for physical delivery, et cetera, would just leave it there. There's no reason to move it. The only entities that would have a reason to move it, take it out, would be industrial users to use in their factories and their ingredients for whatever they use it for, okay? And it's used for thousands of different applications. So the point is this, is that this unique and unprecedented physical turnover, which is, it's guaranteed to have happened. Nobody would lie about it. There's different warehouses, there's different trucking companies, the exchanges involved, sanctioning the statistics. They have auditors, they have accountants, they have lawyers. The government in the form of the CFTC oversees all this. So the idea that it might be there's some phoniness to the reporting is basically preposterous because of all the different parties involved. Plus, why would anybody move it for the sake of moving it? Or why would anybody lie, about this movement taking place? There's no reason to do so. The funny thing is, nobody's even looking at it, even though it's being reported on a daily basis. So it's not like anybody is trying to trick someone and put through phony statistics, because there's no reason to put through the statistics. Nobody's looking at it anyway. The fact of the matter is, though, is that the quantities are so large, like 300 million ounces per year is the average turnover of the last couple of years, and it has to be by industrial users who are taking this stuff out, otherwise it'd just be sitting there. Point being is this, the bottom line on all this thing is that this tremendous turnover equals tremendous industrial user demand with it taking this physical silver out as fast as it's going in. And what that means is the industrial users of silver are using it like never before. Demand has never been higher because the movement, the physical movement, has never been higher. And what that means is that in this just-in-time delivery and manufacturing world is that the users are relying on this silver for daily deliveries. And any little bit of shortage, any little bit of delay in delivering silver to these industrial users is going to set off, in my mind, and I've been expecting it for many years, is going to set off an industrial user inventory buying panic, where just like individuals throughout the country, maybe the world, but certainly in this country, in the springtime when the pandemic hit in full force and the lockdowns began, people started talking about the coronavirus and worrying about it. The first thing they did is they rushed out and bought certain things. Now, why they bought toilet paper, and certain things like that, I don't know. I've never figured it out, but we all know you couldn't buy toilet paper for months, It's just starting to appear now. And this is just a consumer item that is kind of every day. If an industrial user, is faced with the prospect of having to shut down his assembly lines and manufacturing facilities, whether it's for iPhones or Tesla cars or any item you can think of, the choice given to that industrial user, if he can't get his vital silver delivered in time, he is going to panic worse than anybody ever panicked in buying toilet paper. I can assure you that. And what he's going to do is going to rush out and buy even more physical silver to make sure and gain some immunization against continued delivery delays. The problem is that once some industrial users start to do this, okay? It's going to exacerbate the situation, make the supply lines and the delivery delays even longer, and it's going to just panic other industrial users to do it. A silver investor doesn't mind too much, okay, waiting to get delivery of silver that they have bought. It's not a life and death situation for an investor in silver, whether he gets the silver delivered that he bought tomorrow, next week, or next month. It's just not life and death. An industrial user, on the other hand, who's relying on that silver to fulfill and finish his finished product, okay, has no such comfort in waiting out any kind of delay. He needs the stuff. He needs the stuff now. This is a just-in-time world. And if he doesn't get the silver, he's going to panic. And he's going to go out and buy even more. And I think we're getting very close to that. I don't think we're at that point just yet. But the turnover in the COMEX inventories, okay, in silver and not in any other commodity, okay, tells me that these industrial users are buying this stuff and are existing on a hand-to-mouth basis. And any slight disruption in the delivery process, any delay, okay, is going to send some of them into a panic to buy more physical inventory. And when they do that, it's just going to ripple down the chain, and other industrial users are going to wind up doing the same. And if whatever you think the price of silver might go to, some crazy numbers in the hundreds of dollars an ounce, if it's going to get to any of those numbers that people like to throw out, and I don't disagree with them, I don't know what number to put on it, this will be the reason that silver goes to those prices. If we don't have this industrial user panic and demand, I don't know if we will get to those levels. If we do have this industrial user panic, then for sure we're going to get to those price levels. That's basically the story.
Yeah, well, what a great story. And I know it's like we had these COMEX September deliveries in silver coming up, and when you and I talked 2 or 3 weeks ago, you weren't putting as much emphasis on that, but you talked back then about the industrial users. You talked about that for a while, and it sounds like you're, just to summarize, you're saying that these turnover that you see is an indication that at least they're some signs that someone might be noticing at least what happened on the retail market over the last couple of months or so.
Yeah, I suspect that. I guess what I'm looking at, if I had to give some tangible data to why I'm thinking this, is that over the last month or two, okay, the weekly turnover totals, okay, the amount moved each week, each day, okay, has been growing very strongly. In fact, you know, where it used to average, as I said, five or six million ounces a week, over the last 2 months, it's jumped up to maybe double that, to like 12 million ounces a week over the last 2 months or something like that. So there's definitely an increase in the turnover. And I'm just trying to figure out, and I'm throwing it out, is it open that anybody can, I've been soliciting alternative explanations for this specific set of facts, these turnover data. They're hard and fast data that I record every day and have been doing so for close to 30 years or more. And now I'm looking at this data and I'm saying, wait, something's causing this turnover. If it was just straight investment demand, there'd be no reason to take the stuff out. It'd just go right in, and you'd see the warehouse inventories in the COMEX not at 350 million ounces, which is up, it's the highest it's been in ever, but it would be much higher than that. It would be a billion, 2 billion ounces if it was just straight investment demand. The fact that it's coming out so much means that it has to be industrial users. Who else would take it out? So I'm not being dogmatic or hard and fast that this is, I termed it a mystery, okay? I'm asking, you know, other people to think about it and comment on it. What would explain this set of circumstances? I just gave you my story, what I think it is. I'm not saying that's the gospel truth and it's what it is, but I can't find another alternative explanation. What else could it be? What would explain truckloads of silver, 600,000 ounces each, going into and out from the COMEX? Not the same silver, different silver. They keep track of the stuff by serial numbers, et cetera, and it's different silver, I can assure you that. I don't, why else would it be moving if it weren't industrial user demand?
I hear you, and that's why I think everyone, Ted, it's too bad you can't see some of the comments that are coming in of how much people are really appreciating hearing from you and what you laid out, and it makes a lot of sense for me. Fortunately, Clarence Hoover has solved one of the problems. You mentioned the toilet paper shortage, and Clarence says Helicopter Ben will print us all some TP, so I guess that's one thing we can count on. Ted, fortunately, good news, everyone. Ted has agreed to stay and take some questions. We'll see if we can figure out a way to get you into one of those booths. So it might be a couple minutes, folks. Although, Ted, one quick one before we let you go. Let's see if I can phrase this clearly. Let's say we're 5 years from now in 2025. What's the price of silverware if someone said they thought, you know, it's going to be below price X, where you'd be happy to bet anything you have? So, I mean, maybe 5 years from now, you think there's almost zero chance it's going to be below 50 or below some other number, you know. So a couple of years out, what's the lowest possible price you could see silver, let's say, in 2025?
Difficult for me to answer. Let me answer it as the way I envision it, okay? 5 years is a fairly long time. I have a feeling, a strong feeling, that we'll have already gone through the silver price blow-off process by then. I think it's going to be contained within the next 5 years to where I can see silver going to some really crazy price. Look at the crazy prices that we have on some common stocks today, okay, yes, that have gone far beyond, you know, anybody's imagination.
Ted, am I guessing you don't think Tesla is worth 10 times more what it was a year ago?
Well, Nicole, I think, would be a more of an extreme bet than Tesla. At least Tesla, you know, has a working product, but... Well, all I'm trying to say is that take that kind of extreme speculation that we've seen in stock markets that's driven certain price stocks to just prices that you can't believe. And then, you know, what, take that same speculative buying force, apply it to a commodity that's been around for 5,000 years that is known basically to everyone, okay, on the face of the earth above the age of reason, whatever that is, 7 or 10 years old. There's not many people that don't know what silver is, okay? Direct that speculative investment, not on a country basis, just the United States, but around the world, and do it on an item that there may be and should be, and I can't see how there won't be, a even bigger panic by industrial users who need this item, not just to speculate on and make money, but need this item to do their, make their product, whatever it is, and take those two opposing forces, the speculative investment and greed factor that's in part of all of us as investors, and combine it with this industrial demand, and it only exists, this two dual demand between investors and industrial users only exists in silver, no other commodity. I know about platinum, I know about palladium, but they're not as big investment-wise as silver is. Gold is a big investment item, but it's not an industrial item. So only silver has this dual force. So the two of those things coming together, this crazy speculation that's going on in this country and around the world, okay, on stocks, and have that in silver, along with the industrial users panicking, trying to stay in business, and then trying to figure what the price will be. I think the price is going to shoot to some crazy high, burn out at some number that can't possibly be sustainable in the long run, and then fall down at that point sharply, but still be way above what we've come to know it to be, you know, up until now. To pick a price at some point where it's going to be, I wouldn't know, but I think it's going to go crazy to the upside, crazier than anybody can imagine, even me, okay? And then it's not going to be sustainable. It's going to burn itself out, okay, at some point. I don't know, maybe it takes a year or two, I don't know, and then eventually come down. So where along that process is the price going to be at a certain point of time? I wish I knew. I'm nowhere near that smart, but I don't think anybody knows. It's like almost trying to be a prophet, not an analyst or anything like that. But it's going to go much higher than any of us expect, put it that way.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned that, because this is not by any means financial advice, but just my gut intuition tells me that whatever I think would be wild, whenever this finally happens, we've had people talking all weekend about how suppressed the thing has been. I think it'll just blow away whatever I thought was possible. We shall see. Although what is clear is that, Ted, this was just simply awesome. I thank you so much for joining us. I thank you on behalf of everything you've done. And I hear we have a nice silver gift coming your way as well, which we will follow up on. And good news, folks, Ted has kindly agreed to take questions. So we are going to get Ted logged into the Silver Sands booth with Keith. Yara's Keith Anderson still in the Silver Sands booth. We'll track him down. We're going to get you in the Silver Sands booth. And folks, if you've ever wanted to ask Ted Butler your questions, this will be your chance. So, Ted, thank you so much. It's really, how can you have SilverFest without Ted Butler? And thank you so much for joining us. And we'll see you in the booth in a little bit.
Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it.